Hey, you back with the present father in 46. Are you concerned over coronavirus, World War III, the state of our nation, with possibly a new president on the brink? Let me share with you a word that may give you a more grounded stand, some stability, some encouragement in times like these. Actually going to try to excavate an old truth from one of probably the oldest books in the Bible that you may not have known. It's from the book of Job, giving you a little bit of background, tells you how many kids he had, 7 sons, he had 3 daughters. It talks about his wealth. He has like 7,000 sheep, 3,000 oxen. The man had a lot of wealth, and Job was just a righteous man. And his children would meet at the brothers' houses and have this cycle of feasts. And every time these cycles of feasts were finished, he would make sure that he would pray for them and offer sacrifices, the appropriate sacrifices. In case they had sinned against the Lord, he was trying to cover them. And that's just good fatherhood, you know, making intercession for your children. Our prayers are powerful. We're accountable before God to be praying for our children. Suddenly, there's a scene change, and it goes from the natural into the supernatural. And now you're in the presence of God, and it says that the sons of God will present themselves to the Lord. And it says that Satan came with them, so he was among them. And God asked him a very direct question, and I'm sure God expected a direct answer. God says, "Where have you come from?" And I think Satan, just in his just being wicked, he kind of, in a smart alecky way, gives God a broad general answer, like, "Oh, just, you know, to and fro, up and down the earth." God responds, he says, "Have you considered my servant Job?" Of course, the devil does what he's supposed to do, and he starts bringing accusations. "Job is only, he only serves you because you've blessed him, you've set a hedge of protection around him, but he'll curse you if you take all his stuff away." And God actually gives the enemy permission to go and take away everything he has, like all in an instant. Even his children are taken away. They die, and he's left with nothing. So then we move into chapter 2. It's almost like a repeat of what happened in chapter 1. God says, "Have you considered my servant Job?" And the devil's accusing again. He says, "Well, you know, skin for skin. Take away his health, he'll for sure curse you." So God allows that to happen to Job. It allows him to be infected with these gruesome sores and all over his body from head to toe. Even his wife is saying, "Won't you just curse God and die?" He doesn't. He keeps his integrity. His 3 friends come over to be with him and to comfort him. But it turns into a meeting to accuse. You know, Job's in a hard spot, and he starts pouring out his heart, and he's kind of starts putting God in a bad light as he's making some utterances based out of his pain, not cursing the Lord, but given the situation, he starts talking and trying to defend himself and starts misrepresenting who God is. And his friends, they're just not having it. They're like, "You did something. There's something wrong with your life. There's nothing wrong with God." And in a sense, they're correct, but they're out of season.
Misrepresenting who God is.
They're not being good, understanding friends. You know, this is a man who's got everything taken away. They over there telling him, the reason why this happened to you is because something wrong with you. That ain't what he needed to hear at that time. So a 4th friend comes over. He was the youngest of Job's friends that were currently there. And he starts dropping knowledge. At the end of his speech, suddenly the Lord starts speaking and setting everybody straight. He starts explaining to them how much they don't know and how foolish they are trying to come off high sounding from such a limited perspective. But he never said anything against Job's 4th friend. So they all humbled themselves before Yahweh, before the Lord. God ends up blessing Job double for his trouble. But here's the thing, here's the key. So before, he may have had 7,000 sheep, now he's got 14,000. He may have had 3,000 oxen before, now he's got 6,000. Thing is when it comes to God doubling his family, Yahweh doesn't seem to double the numbers. of the children that he lost, because he gave him back 7 sons and gave him back 3 daughters. Now, why is that? Why did he double all of his wealth, but he didn't double his children? Well, there's a reason for that. And I believe that this is the whole point of the story, is that God is saying, your children are still with me. Your children are still here. And yes, now you do have 14 sons. Yes, you do have now 6 daughters. But half of them are with me and half of them are with you. And I think that is a very deeply profound thought that is easily skipped over in the book of Job. Because we're not to live just for this present age. The glory that's going to come after is greater than all the suffering we endure here on the earth. We got to look toward eternal things, because there is a realm that is beyond this little speck of time. It's a vapor of time. It's nothing. We got to set our eyes on eternity. And if we've lost children, if we've lost loved ones, most of us have, if we are ourselves on the edge of death, it's very comforting to know that by faith, if you read God's word, if you pay attention to the story of Job, God is unveiling a secret, much to our benefit, that in his benevolent sovereignty, he allows things to happen here on earth. But if you are one of his, we get to move on to eternity with him, with all our other loved ones that are believers, that love God. There is a glory after all of this. We don't need to be utterly discouraged. We have hope beyond the here and now. We have hope beyond this broken, fallen world. This isn't it. God doubled Job's children also. When this little bit of time was over and he came to the end of his life and his children came to the end of their lives, they would have reached their eternal destiny, as all of us will who are in Christ, who've put our trust in what he's done on the cross, who believe in his death and his resurrection. He is the author of life. We have inherited life through him. Be encouraged, fellow fathers. I say be encouraged, be strengthened. There is a glorious eternity beyond this dark and broken place we currently live in now. Let's celebrate that. Let's try to live that out right now. Let's colonize the kingdom even here and now. Let's go against the grain, swim against the current, and live this kingdom life, because we know who wins in the end. God in his benevolent sovereignty is a conqueror, and he's ultimately victorious. We have inherited the victory. All right, y'all, till next time. Get with you. Present Father N46. Please like and subscribe to my channel, especially if you've been encouraged. I'm going to continue to bring you content that will enhance, encourage, empower you in your fatherhood. If you do not have a family yet or looking forward to being a good father, please like and subscribe. Leave some comments. Talk to me. Blessings and peace to you in Jesus' name and to your families. May God richly bless you, and may you look forward to the glory that is to come.